has performance of the tunnel junction with high speed, and also at the same time the magnetic properties of the magnetic layer. And plenty of experimental group tries to do such junctions, measure it, and from our way we made some theoretical calculations and formulate most of the operation of this junction and find that in which case which result will be. And generally our first models are qualitatively same with experimental results. So there is dependence of creeping current versus thickness for different thickness of the superconducting layer, the magnetic layer, and actually the picture is the same. However, there were some different troubles because, for example, there is no zero pi transition and high thickness of central layer. And it was a reason to make additional theoretical investigations, which leads to some additional papers after that. However, at the moment, we understand the behavior of this system as a static regime without voltage. And we can find creeping current, current phase relation, and so on. But experimental people mostly ask the results of voltage of dynamical properties. And it was reason to try to understand what can be appears in such system when we apply voltage. And we start to see what effects we can estimate. And the number of effects were very large. So there are some different effects. The first one, which provides some specific behavior of the dynamics, is a charge balance of condensate. It was proposed by Kayama Tachiki and appears in the Josephson stacks, is very thin interlayers. And the idea of coupling corresponding that if your interlayer is very thin around some constraints, electric field in one junction is not screening but this field. And independent different electric fields in the different interlayers for with some junctions, leading to appearance of additional charge on the superconducting layer. And however, here this type of coupling, the characteristic length is the bilength, so this effect appears only on scales around 2 or 3 angstroms. And in our structure, the scales middle layer is around 10 nanometers. So actually, we can exclude this mechanism. The second mechanism of coupling between junction is a quasi-particle accumulation. It corresponds to the presence of quasi-particles, which appears after the sort of going of the single junction in the voltage state into the resistive state. The quasi-particles leads to appearance of additional charge in the middle layer due to quasi-particle imbalance in the system. And characteristic length of this effect is quasi-particle relaxation length. And this value is higher and can be comparable with other nanometers. So probably this effect can appear in our junctions. The next mechanism of coupling is inductive coupling between two junctions. And it corresponds to interaction between two Josephson vortexes going parallel through one on the second junction. It also reasonable type of interaction. However, at the moment we try to dream about small junctions, which is much smaller size than Josephson interaction depths. So now we don't consider this type of interaction. And the fourth effect is a proximity effect, because we which correspond to impact of the ferromagnetic layer on the content side in the thin superconductive layer, which can change properties, and even this impact of ferromagnetic layer can change the critical current and the voltage characteristics of tunnel-Josephson junction. But actually, now we start to try to concentrate on this mechanism and try to understand what this mechanism can do. Actually, the best way how to calculate it is write microscopic equation in Kellogg's formulas, like in such papers. But this approach is very complicated, and for each of mechanism there are some more simplified approaches, and we try to use one of them, which was proposed by Rendick in the late 90s. I will start from some basics of Josephson effects. I usually try to avoid this slide, but here it will be helpful. So actually, now Josephson junction, there are two main properties that the current phase relation determines the superconducting current, and usually it is superconducting current is proportional to sinus of the Josephson phase. Also the Josephson effect, yeah, the link between phase and voltage, and presence of some capacitance in the model or in the system. To simplify system, we will try to describe our junction just in a RG model to make some analytical results. So in this case, the current balance equation is like that, and the characteristic parameter is the speed of the junction, and Stewart-McCumber parameter, which correspond to capacitance of the junction. And for this parameter, there are two types of behavior for the junction: overdamped and underdamped. In the overdamped, if we increase current until critical, then we go up like that and back through the same line. But if Stewart-McCumber parameter is large, then we increase our current until critical, then jump to the resistive state and going back by this theoretic way from until zero current without going to superconductive state away. Okay, and now we try to understand which junctions is better to describe our systems with one tunnel junction and one ferromagnetic junction. And for zero approximation, we choose that we need to describe asymmetric stack, where one junction is a fast capacitive junction with very high performance and with hysteretic behavior, while the second junction, which corresponds to some metallic junction, is a junction with almost zero capacitance and with slow speed. We call this junction slow and this fast. And our coupling process gives us some modification of RG model, because in this case the chemical potential of the condenser is changed due to the presence of some charge in the middle layer, which leads to additional factor in Josephson law, which correspond to psi. And this psi is potential of quasi-particle charge of quasi-particles, and it can be determined from the kinetic equations, which has a very clear physical meaning. So it corresponds that quasi-particle charge is determined by the incoming and outgoing flow of quasi-particles, and has some relaxation term, which leads to disappearance of the quasi-particles and relaxation with the time at the times around quasi-particle relaxation times tau. Actually, we can consider this kinetic equation as phenomenological. However, in some previous work of Rendick, it was microscopically derived for some certain conditions. Okay, let's start to try something with our system, because about novelty that usually all people before use such equation only to consideration of spectral stacks, because they mostly interesting in some high temperatures conductance or so on. But now we try to make it for some asymmetry system. Okay, if relaxation fast, the case one, then in our kinetic equation we can exclude this term. It just writes that quasi-particle potential equal some value connected with the voltage of the first and the second junction. And it momently gives us some modified equations, and after some simplification, it gives the strange result that critical current of the second junction increased in 1 plus kappa r times, where kappa r is coupling parameter between the system. So it is correspond to the quasi-particle relaxation time and resistance of the system. And this parameter in some systems can reach around 0.1 or even 1 for slow systems. It is interesting because we can consider the system with junction with critical current, for example, critical current 2, but when we start to increase current in the system, we find that any transition to voltage state of this junction is going at the value 6. So in this case, our coupling gives to increase of the critical current. Moreover, at the same time, while there is no phase behavior, phase increase of the slow junction while the fast in the resistive state, there is some voltage on even on the slow junction. So the real mechanism of increase of the critical current that fast junction in the resistive state provides some field and some quasi-particle current which gives voltage and real current, super current in the in the second junction is smaller than critical one. So there is no phase growth of the junction, but there is a voltage with a frequency of the fast junction. So the frequency is same. There is some phase shift between these two dependents for the first and the second. But when we go higher than the critical current, the second junction also start to generate on his slow frequency, while the first one generate on his fast. Okay, the next case is a case when a slow junction, thermionic junction, has critical current smaller than tunnel junction. In this case, the mathematics become slightly complicated, because previously we can just write that tunnel junction going to the resistive state, and we can solve all equations very simple. But here we go to the equations of such field which has some analytical solutions proposed by Asamazov, Larkin, and we find that that effective critical current of the other junction in this case can also increase and can be also decreased. So there is in the system two different mechanisms. One mechanism is similar with previous case, which increase effective critical current of the set of one junction. It is this term. But the second mechanism decrease it, and it corresponds to some to large amplitude of phase oscillations in the system. Also very interesting property in this case that if we increase our current from zero up to high values, at the first point the slow junction going to the resistor state and fast junction stay in the superconductor state like that. But when we increase the second critical current, when fast junction go to the resistor state, it switch off his property of injecting of quasi particles in the central layer, and then increasing effective critical current of the previous junction, which was in the resistor state, and switch off the second junction. So, as in this case, we make some jump on the IP curve, which correspond to switching of the one junction, switching off of the one junction, which already working before it. Also, if we try to understand what is the number of critical current, we find that there is some jumps behavior. And these jumps really correspond to the terms which link to the, this Bessel term, which appears in the system in the case of overdamped junction. Okay, and final case is a slow quasi-particle relaxation. In this case, our kinetic equation corresponds to the average values. And then we find that the system, when one junction is a resistor state and the second is a superconductor state, is the same. But if the second junction goes to the resistor state, then the behavior of IV curve become hysteretic, even without capacitance of this second junction. So we find the value of this second critical current, and then we show the appearance of additional hysteretic behavior on IV curves, leading to can be reasoned by quasi particle effects in the system. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Questions, please.
Metallic junction or some shunted tunnel junction.
So, okay, and then what should be a shunt in ohms, kilohms?
I guess some kilometers. Some kilohms.
Some kilohms?
I'm not sure about it because I don't work mostly with shunted junctions. So usually in configuration it's something like an SNS junction or a SPS junction.
What about kilohms?
Maybe just like a small, very general. Maybe can you summarize briefly what is the main effect?
Main effect is the changing of the critical current in the system due to quasi-particle implants in the system, or the quasi-particle coupling in the system. So, yeah, we have critical current, real critical current of the junction equal to, but in the result of this effect, we find that the system going to the resistor state at value 6 and going back at the value 4.
Okay,
So you consider some explanation for the theoretical aspect. So how is the practical knowledge of your explanation? Because the practical plays an important role here, in my opinion.
Yeah, practical role here, that if you found in your junction some additional hysteresis, it can be explained not by capacitance of this junction,
yeah,
but also by such effect. And it is suitable for some non-trivial case, because I see in the literature very similar hysteresis of such type.
But when you are looking for reality, would say German, so how is the difference between the first step or first preliminary step to final results? So how is difference? How percentage, for example, 20%, 30%?
It very depends from the resistance of that junction. And the smaller resistance, the higher this effect.
Okay.
And for estimations,
but resistance will depend on the metal, which metal
yeah,
depends.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, sorry, okay. We have well everything behind, and we have to move on. Thank you very much again.
The last important talk before lunch.
From another sublattice, so one black and one bright atoms. Therefore, in the single layer graphene there are six phonon branches, three acoustic and three optic. Two of them, ZA, Z acoustic, and ZO, Z optic, are out of plane branches. Atoms from these branches vibrate in the direction perpendicular to the sheet of graphene layer. The rest four phonon branches are in-plane phonon branches. The displacement vectors of phonon modes from these four branches have only in-plane components, so atoms vibrate in-plane of graphene sheet. Gamma point, the brilliant zone of graphene is a hexagon. The gamma point is at the center of this hexagon. 6K points are at the hexagon corners, and 6M points are at the middle of the hexagon sides. When one graphene layer are placed on top of each other, they can form a moiré pattern. There are two different moiré patterns. There are two different moiré patterns, commensurate and non-commensurate. In the case of commensurate moiré patterns, the periodicity of the crystal lattice retains, but the unit cell is larger than in the single layer graphene, and it depends on the rotational angle. The number of atoms in the unit cell also is a function of the rotational angle. Corresponding Brillouin zone volume is smaller than in the case of graphene layers. In the case of non-commensurate moiré patterns, there is no periodicity in the crystal lattice. So one important, very important thing from the rotation is the dependence of the volume of crystal of the unit cell of crystal lattice or of the Brillouin zone of crystal lattice on the rotational angle. In this slide, I show very briefly details of our calculation approach. For the calculation of phonon dispersions, we used variance force. We used lattice dynamic model of phonons with Born von Karman type potentials for in-plane interaction and Lennard-Jones potential for interlayer interaction, for interaction between atoms from the two different layers. The evolution of phonon energy spectra from single layer graphene, bilayer graphene without twist, and twisted bilayer graphene with different rotational angle, 21.8 and 30.2 degrees, are shown in the slide. And you can see that the phonon energy spectra in twisted bilayer graphene look very different from energy spectra in single layer or bilayer graphene. But it is important to note here that both spectra are plotted for gamma k direction in the Brillouin zone. In the Brillouin zone of twisted bilayer graphene is smaller, and gamma k direction in the Brillouin zone of twisted graphene also is smaller in comparison with gamma k direction in bilayer graphene or single layer graphene. If we will compare two modes from bilayer graphene and twisted bilayer graphene, we will see that the energy will be equal, but the phonon momentum will be different. So twisting affects the phonon properties and phonon modes owing to two reasons. First, twisting changes weak van der Waals interaction between layers, and twisting changes the phonon momenta. Here you can see large red hexagon or large black hexagon is a Brillouin zone of untwisted bilayer graphene. Small hexagons are Brillouin zone of twisted graphene with rotational angle 21.8 degrees. You can see that in the bilayer graphene without twist, 7 directions, gamma 0, k 0, gamma 1, k 1, gamma 2, k 2, up to gamma 6, k 6, are different directions. But in the case of twisted graphene, these directions correspond to one single direction, gamma 0, k 0. Therefore, In twisted bilayer graphene appear new type of hybrid phonon modes resulting from the mixing of phonon modes from different directions in brillouin zone of bilayer graphene without twist. Therefore, we see here many phonon branches, and number of phonon branches strongly depends on the rotational angle. If we will analyze phonon group velocities or two-dimensional density of states, which are very important for description of phonon-assisted processes, we will see that the difference between bilayer graphene without twist and single in bilayer graphene with twist is very small. You can see that the pictures for different type of graphene are coincides, with exception of energy range between 90 up to 110 inverse centimeter, where we see clearly where we can see clear difference in the phonon density of states due to change of ZA phonon modes. And we can conclude and expect that possible difference in phonon-assisted processes in twisted and bilayer graphene and non-twisted bilayer graphene would not be explained due to difference in phonon density of states or average group velocity. But when we make twist, we change phonon momentum. The difference, the slight difference in phonon density of states affect phonon specific heat at small temperatures. Temperature dependence of specific heat in twisted, in bilayer graphene without twist, in single layer graphene is approximately T in power 1, but in twisted bilayer graphene it approximately T in power 1.3. And temperature dependence at small temperatures depends also on rotational angle. This is manifestation of slight difference between ZA phonon modes. But if we will analyze dependence of phonon thermal conductivity on temperature in twisted graphene, TBLG, single layer graphene, ABBLG, so bilayer graphene without twist, we will see that the thermal conductivity in twisted bilayer graphene is suppressed in comparison with single or bilayer graphene without twist. And this manifestation of the change in the phonon momentum. Qualitatively, we can explain this change using these plots. In bilayer graphene without twist, this free phonon process is not possible because momentum is not conserved. While in the case of twisted bilayer graphene, the similar free phonon process is possible because momentum is conserved in the case of twisted bilayer graphene due to the change in the phonon momentum. And as a result, we have more strong scattering of phonons by phonons in the twisted bilayer graphene, and we have a drop of thermal conductivity by a factor approximately between 1.5 up to 2 orders of by a factor of 1.5 to 2 at room temperature. And my short conclusion. So, new type of hybrid phonon modes appear in the twisted bilayer graphene due to the mixing of phonons from different directions of unrotated, of the brillouin zone of unrotated graphene, and this change strongly influences the thermal conductivity. Thank you very much. Okay, 10 minutes.
And what's going to happen if the angle will be very small, like 1 degree?
I think that for the very small but commensurate angle, we will obtain trend to the bibliography.
1 degree, suppose it's small but not commensurate.
In the case for non-commensurate Myhre potence, I do not know what we will have. Because for the in our theory, we described only commensurate systems. If we have non-commensurate systems, we have not periodicity. It means that we should apply another theoretical approach for modeling of thermoconductivity. And I don't know what we will see.
Well, not thermal conductivity, what is interesting, but just the spectrum. Say, based on your experience.
I think that for very small angles, we will see many, many branches, but this volume of Brillouin zone will small, very small, and probably will be some kind of peculiarities due to the momentum conservation laws. But I am not able to say.
Thank you.
Other questions? Yes, very short. It was said that the superconductivity was actually discovered.
Yes.
I don't know, of course, maybe you did not calculate, but are you aware of any calculations of, let's say, using some Elias-Bregg model, using this electrical coupling?
Okay, in my group, in my group, up to now, no, but maybe in the future.
Well, let's speak again. We'll discuss physics of superconductor to insulator transition.
Okay, so good afternoon. First, I'd like to thank Anatoly for having me here and giving me the pleasure of talking in front of such a select audience. It's indeed a great pleasure to be here. So what we're going to discuss is actually the result of work of our remarkable and big international group of collaborators, one of them is here. So I will not go across every name because it will take the most part of my talk. So let's get directly to business. And what I'm going to do, first I have to thank for discussions, Duncan Haldane and Michael Postolis. I don't know Duncan very well, so he was alive and supportive, but the old friend for many years, Mike Kostelitz, imposed all the criticism possible, and since the topic survived, then I was completely happy with it. So what I'm going to do is to give it, since our conference and the topic is broad, I'm going to give it completely different twist, and not talking about particular applications and use for practical life, but focus on the opposite, on the sort of unexpected outcome for the very fundamental physics. And therefore, we start from there. So one of the most glamour and fundamental areas of modern physics is still considered to be high energy physics. Just the key to all the mysteries of the universe and even more. And the modern progress started with this notion by Gell-Mann and Zweig when they invented quarks and taught us that all the elementary particles made out of quarks. And what is so peculiar about this beautiful church with quarks is that the interaction on large, of course, large as compared to really microscopic scales, that the interaction force doesn't depend on the distance, meaning that unlike usual Coulomb interaction, the energy of interaction, quark interaction, grows linearly with the increasing distance. And that's why these quarks cannot be seen outside the elementary particles they compose, and that's why they are so interesting. Then it was another advance in quantum chromodynamics, because it was a great problem. Everything was like diverging at small distances, unless, well, actually the story is a little bit more complicated and more long and more interesting, unless the notion of asymptotic freedom was invented. And it was invented that it was realized that quarks, which are strongly attracted at long distances, and don't interact with the distances between them, become really small. This saved chromodynamics and quantum electrodynamics. This discovery, for which they got the Nobel Prize, and, well, then brought this notion of asymptotic freedom. Now, why am I talking about this? Because, actually, quantum chromodynamics is organized like that. At small distances, it works pretty well, because perturbative approach works. At large distances, when interactions become really strong, perturbation theory doesn't work anymore. And this is where string theory comes into place. And these quarks are supposed to be held together by chromodynamic strings, color strings. And then, okay, on a graphic language, you understand the string, the more you pull it, the stronger it resists. So this is where this linear increase in the interaction energy is coming from. And so the reason I'm talking about this is because one of the best working versions of the quark interaction was proposed by Jared Doft, who also got the Nobel Prize for that, who proposed what is called dual superconductivity model for quark interaction. And he called it dual superconductivity because the theory which he composed for the quark matter was exactly the theory of superconductivity with one small deal. It was not superconductivity if he proposed and he actually derived that in his semi-classical approach, string approach, that this quark matter is a dual mirror image of superconductivity, but it has infinite resistance instead of infinite. And he even coined the term superinsulator for this quark matter, because it has which one should work? Okay, it doesn't matter. Okay, so this was the development. So he coined this term, and as we know, this term superinsulator appeared in the theory of superconductor insulator transition, and only after like years of studies we learned where this term is coming from, and we discovered that this Toft suggestion and the theory he outlined is the exact copy of what we did for our superinsulator, but condensed matter physics. So now I can come over to superconductor insulator transition, and since, okay, it is a nice thing to start with the history, then the history of superconductor insulator transition was initiated by Jan Shelnikov, who was the first to make the film 1 nanometer thin, and discover that then superconducting temperature, transition temperature, is strongly suppressed in these fields. Then the next person who realized what is actually the nature of superconductor insulated transition and realized how to treat experimental data and that the criterion for the insulating behavior is thermal activation behavior was Marin Strandin. And then the first theory of the superconductor insulated transition for the system is of granular metal, granular superconductor, was done in a beautiful paper by Kostin Fedov in 1980. So this was the beginning of the story, but this story came to fruition when Alan Goldman and his group indeed discovered and investigated indeed the superconductor insulated transition. This is a iconic picture of the experimental data. So you see these fan-like curves, as we call them now. So this is temperature dependence of the resistance, and this is the thickness of the film from thick to very thin, which is the measure and the degree and the tuning by disorder. So you see transition from superconducting behavior when resistance goes to zero to insulating behavior, where one can see, can check that there is thermally activated behavior indeed. And one of the last data, where the data obtained by Tatiana Patudina and her group, where this superconductor insulated transition was really very abrupt and narrow. Basically, when you look at this zoo of experimental data, you will see that there are two different scenarios which are possible. One is when you have the direct superconductor insulated transition, sharp, and another one when this transition occurs through the intermediate metallic region, and this was the first puzzle which this new phenomenon posited. Then there were two theories, independent. One by Sasha Finkelstein, who just proposed and calculated actually how disorder destroys, repairs, and causes transition from the superconductivity to metallic behavior. And another one proposed by Matthew Fisher, who proposed completely different scenario, which is called Bazzoni scenario nowadays, and who told us that when you increase disorder, the first thing which may happen is not that Cooper pairs get destroyed, but that Cooper pairs get localized, and this is what is an insulator. So then it was like the puzzle, however, still remained, why sometimes we see the direct transition and sometimes we see the transition through the metal, because this theory didn't resolve it. One of the things which Matthew Fisher obtained by his very elegant consideration was that if the transition point, one should have the key medium should be a metal, and not just the metal, but quantum metal having quantum resistance. And then it was, again, unrelated story taking us back to the field theory. It was a group which was working in the beautiful city of Perugia in Italy, who considered, they were field theorists for whatever reason, they decided to consider Josephson junction ray, just a standard thing for us, and construct a field theory, gauge field theory for the superconducting, okay, Josephson junction array, and find out that if they make just small twist with the Hamiltonian and make this Hamiltonian completely true, then they will see immediately the phase which is a mirror image of superconductivity, but which has infinite resistance instead of infinite conductance. And once again, they use this term superinsulator without knowing about Toft. And then it was indeed the first experimental observation of this superinsulating behavior. This was titanium nitrate film, which is very convenient for this kind of measurements because it shows so sharp superconductor insulated transition. And if we take the sample, which is just like, let's say, first insulating first insulating cell here. Then, if we try to see what's going to happen with the differential conductivity here, then we can see that as soon as we decrease temperature, it really jumps into the new state, which has infinite resistance, as long as the applied voltage doesn't exceed some threshold value. Well, we can play a little bit more, and we can see how one can drive this transition not by temperature, but also by the magnetic field. And then it was realized that basically this super insulating phase, which appears in the vicinity of superconductor insulated transition, is in fact a low temperature Bezinski-Kosterlitz-Towers phase, which appears as a result of Bezinski-Kosterlitz-Towers transition. And the first indication that this Kosterlitz-Towers transition can make a significance there was experimental realization of the fact that activation energy in the insulating phase, which you see in these thin films, has activation energy which logarithmically scales with the sample size, which was absolutely unexpected, counterintuitive, and didn't fit any reasonable understanding of what is going on. But this tells us immediately that the interaction between charges in this phase is not usually Coulomb interaction, but two-dimensional, logarithmic Coulomb interaction. It's another thing how this can happen. So this is so much for the experiment. This is the summary of what we learned in this experiment. And now it was realized that the superconductor, superinsulator duality really works, and we can see how it works. But first of all, what we can do, just for the fun of it, is to formulate the whole course of superconductivity in two sentences. Basically, the course of superconductivity can be done in two sentences plus one experimental fact, Meissner effect. If we know that there is Meissner effect on superconductors, then we immediately know that the phase is fixed there. And then we know that since we have condensative Cooper pairs, and since the amplitude and the phase of the condensate wave function compete according to the uncertainty principle, then we immediately know that as soon as we have the phase which is fixed, then we have variation in the charge indefinite, and then it means that the condensate should move without scattering, because had it been scattering, then it would be possible to count the particles in the condensate, which is impossible. Basically, the course of superconductivity is finished at this point, and the rest is just technical exercises for good first year or second year students. Now, what we can immediately do, using once again this uncertainty principle, is to reverse it and say, well, suppose that we managed to pin the charges. Well, since we work as theorists for the moment, this is not our heading how to do it. That experiment is too sweet. But suppose we have done it. But then it immediately means that now the phase is indefinite, and since the phase has fluctuated as it wishes, then it means by Josephson relation that we do have voltage across the sample in the absence of the current. This immediately means infinite resistance. So this means that if we do have superconductivity, then we should have superinsulating phase, which is due to superconductivity. And it's nice to understand that from this fundamental point of view, how to realize it, it's a different story. For the experimentalists. And now we can immediately establish, indeed, for the moment it's just a picture, but correspondence between superconductor and superinsulator. And remember this tough notion that, okay, that quarks are connected by strings. And then we can imagine for one moment that our Cooper pairs are also going to be connected in a superinsulator by strings, electric strings now, not magnetic strings like vortices, but electric strings. And this is why the superinsulator has this huge resistance. Well, then we can check. What we can check experimentally is if we can see on the insulating side now the same Costa-Stavros transition which we promised. We have done, okay, the proper experiments, and we can immediately see that if we take, okay, this original data for the resistance, which look quite chaotic, but replotted in the corresponding coordinates, actually all the skill of the experimentalist is not only just, okay, to like turn the handles, but to choose proper coordinates in which you can replot your data and see what is happening, okay, in reality. So if we replot this data properly, we immediately see that it shows critical Costa-Stavros behavior, and it shows actually, okay, this five orders of magnitude is sort of unprecedented for the experiment. And another thing which we can get from this measurements, okay, from which on which I cannot unfortunately to dwell too much, is that, okay, this is sort of magnified deviation from the critical behavior, and usually these deviations from critical behavior are taken with the pleasure by experimentalists, because if the agreement is absolutely ideal, then the immediate reaction of the public and the special referees is that, okay, someone is cheating. Either the experimentalists with their data or those who are fitting this data to the theory. So it's very nice to have this disagreement, small disagreement between theory and experiment, and basically it was observed many times for the superconductor, on the superconducting side, but nobody, okay, really cared to analyze this deviation. And we found out that we just inspect this deviation a little bit too closely, then we immediately see that we can measure the dielectric constant of the material out of this, and well, and this is, and this behaves exactly as promised. It diverges when the system goes to the superconductor and insulated transition. And then we can make a cross-check, because according to the predictions of the theory, the activation energy which we see in the experiment should be Costa-Stavros transition temperature times log of the screen, electrostatic screening lens, and you can immediately see that these points wonderfully collapse on top of each other, which establishes the existence of superinsulator near the superconductor insulator transition experiment. Now what we can do, we can, okay, inspired by good experiment, we can try to compose the theory. So the theory is just, okay, this is a set of trivial, how I'm about the time, Sasha?
5 minutes.
5 minutes? Oh, then I have to move fast. So we do it like in a usual textbook, just only symmetry and gauge invariance. And the essence of the theory which we propose is that we took into account Aronoff-Bohm interaction explicitly. In field theory, this is called Chern-Simons theorem, which is normally overlooked in the theory of superconductor insulator transition. So, first, we just introduced notation for the world lines of vortices and Cooper pairs. So, we have just phenomenology. We have vortices, we have Cooper pairs. So, we can immediately write down the action, like in the textbook, and then add derivatives of the fields to this action, and then we have action which completely describes superconductor insulator transition, so the work is done, now it's just exercise for the students. We have to integrate out all the unnecessary degrees to obtain one or another phase. Okay, so this is the notations. Okay, one thing, unfortunately, I have to stop. So if we look at the action, we can immediately see that there are two characteristic energies there. One is the energy of Cooper pairs, Coulomb energy, and another is the energy of vortices. But everybody who was doing, for example, charge density waves knows immediately that in the action of this type, there is a third energy, which is square root of this two. The energy of the soliton or instanton, depending on like philosophy and notations. Then we can immediately develop very simple technique how to learn which phase is realized depending on the parameter, and on passing we immediately resolve the so-called pass. Why sometimes we have direct transition, superconductor insulated transition, but sometimes we have it through the intermediate metallic phase. So the physical explanation is simple. If our quantum fluctuation is strong enough, and this fine structure constant is a measure of quantum fluctuations, then these fluctuations destroy either condensate of the group pairs or the condensate of vortices, and then we have the metallic phase, which is metallic phase, but it's strange, we don't know its nature. Okay, still this is this parameter, and what we can do next, then we can just look back at the phase diagram which we have composed for the superconductor insulated transition, and then I can ask the respected audience if this phase diagram presents something. Just spend 10 seconds, I don't have more time. Do you recognize it? No. This is just a standard phase diagram. It's high, from high energy physics, which is just like one-to-one correspondence. It's pleasant. And now we can do like, okay, some integration out, and we can obtain the action for super insulator, and then indeed, immediately look at the super insulator. So, as I said, this is the work for students. We immediately recognize the Birkhoff compact action from quantum electrodynamics, from which we immediately get these electric strings, which indeed couple this, okay, or bind together with the pairs. Well, then we can play a little bit more. We can investigate the temperature transition from super insulating to usual insulator phase. This is what's called the confinement transition in field theory. And as we know, it belongs to the same universality class. Actually, this is exactly the same as Costa-Gustavus transition in usual statistical physics. So it's just okay. All the ends are tight. Now, what we can do out of it? It means that we can do a thing which all the CERN and all its super colliders is unable to do. For example, we can measure the tension of this Polyakov's electric string. Actually, we can look inside the meson and we can study the behavior of quarks, which is not possible to do in high energy physics because quarks cannot be seen. We can have only circumstantial evidences for this. In our case, it's just electric measurements which give us all the characteristics of it. Okay, this I have to skip. This I also have to skip. One more thing. What we can immediately see in our samples is the realization of the asymptotic freedom when quarks don't interact. So you can see, so this is the usual resistive curves versus inverse temperature, which show insulating behavior as long as samples are large, but immediately saturate to metallic behavior, meaning that Cooper pairs move but don't interact, as soon as the sample becomes really small. And we can make an estimate for, okay, for the size of the sample, which provides this asymptotical free behavior. And much to our surprise, despite the theory is very crude, it's just phenomenology, we have quite good agreement with our experimental observation. Well, we can understand the appearance of Bose metal, this strange metal from the same uncertainty principle, so because we have a third possibility that these uncertainties both non-zero but quantized, this immediately gives us the absence of the condensate. Then we can do once again the same thing, integrate out the degrees of freedom we don't need, obtain the action for the Bose metal, and immediately see that this Bose metal is actually a topological insulator. So where, okay, this topological insulated behavior is coming from, because of the strong Gromov-Bohm interaction in the bulk, so they cannot move, neither vortices nor pairs, but the edge modes contribute to the resistance or conductivity and give exactly quantum resistance in the case of the ideal duality. Okay, so this is, well, then, okay, if I have time, I can stop on the experiment. I won't risk to reproduce. Someone who speaks German can quote this from, this beautiful Faust. And I won't ask if someone remembers the whole scene completely. This we will discuss if we have time. So we come to this evergreen tree of the experiment and the reality. And so what we did the experiments of the super insulator. And this is, another experiment on which we got the direct measurements of the string tension. So basically, this curves show us that there is a mixed state in the super insulator, which is absolutely dual, and which is a mirror image of the superconducting mixed state, but we have electric strings there instead of vortices. And then these two voltages here correspond to lower and up and upper critical fields, HC1 and HC2, but for super insulators. And then, knowing them, we can immediately measure the tension of the string. And well, it is given by the slope. So this is what we've got from the experiment, and this is what we've got from the calculations, which I consider as a quite fair coincidence. Well, basically, this is the end of the story. Almost one more experimental data is involved. So we have two now phase transitions. If we go across the transition, for example, using magnetic field as a tuning parameter. First, we have a transition from the superconductor to this bosonator. In case we have this indirect transition. And then we have transition from this bosonator to an insulator. And according to this field theory, both this transition supposed to be quantum Gostin-Stavros transitions. And then we can check if it is indeed so. So those are experimental curves. Now we do our usual scaling work. It's just the repetition of this graph, curves. And this is how this Gostin-Stavros scaling does work. Well, works pretty well, I would say. So it's not the final evidence, but at least strong indication that what we see is indeed experimentally, is indeed exactly what we predict in theory. So this is a little bit more experimental data showing that indeed we have a topological insulator, which is also metal, but and this is conclusions, and thank you for your attention.
So they move freely, and then they just leave.
constrict force lines which are not spread over the bulk of the film, not for the British book anymore, but namely the tube of the electric field forces. And this is the string. So it's one-dimensional problem. So if you have a one-dimensional electric field, as you know, if you have two plates of the capacitor, when you take them apart, the force, the attraction force between these plates of the capacitor in one-dimensional case doesn't depend on the distance. So this is the origin of the linear dependence. It's one-dimensional electric problem. In one word, you could say that the reason is vortex components.
Okay. More questions? Maybe a very basic one. So you started from two scenarios, like bosonic and fermionic. So maybe for my own thing, what now is your picture?
It's wonderful question again, it's just okay to the point because it's not quite clear to them, but it looks like that both of them do work pretty well. Because like Finkelstein's picture worked pretty well, you can see from all the curves, as long as you are far from the transition. However, when you come close to the transition, well, for there can be many reasons for that. Like, it doesn't work that well. And then this bosonic picture comes into play because, well, basically what happens there, and we have some experimental indications to that, that we have sort of self-induced electronic granular case structure of the sensors. And in this case, we have just, these pools or puddles of bosons, Cooper pairs, in which these Cooper pairs get localized because of the original random potential, but then this, they make the force, which is, the pattern, which is enforced by the strong Coulomb forces. And it's actually, you get the lattice of these puddles, and then it's exactly this bosonic scenario, so they sort of like, there's crossover from one to another. But this is at the level of the hypothesis right now.
Maybe the last question.
I would like to ask you about this topological insulator state that you have. So it's not conventional topological insulator because you're not an inorbit diffraction.
Absolutely correct. This is not absolutely correct. That's an impression. Thanks. It's not the usual one because it's a long distance theory, just in knowledge. And this is bosonic insulator, it's not the electron topological insulator. And the origin of it is not just the change of the bulk electron spectrum and the corresponding metallic behavior at the surface. So we have strong aronoid bond forces which prevent motion in the bulk. It's like vortex over there plus something like that. And then we have just edge modes, surface modes, which we need to restore edge variance of the system, and which then can move free. So Cooper pairs move freely as they should, so they provide the current, and the voltage which you measure is just due to phase slips, which go across this edge channel. So in the case, in ideal duality of clouding resistance, as you go to one or another side of it, and of the transition, you have the resistance which is either smaller than clouding or larger than. But it's bosonic insulator and it's not exactly this.
Okay, in lieu of time, I think we'll make also continue discussions after, but now let's thank Valeria here.
I think it's a little bit of a problem because Professor Jensen is not right yet, so you leave it off. Now we'll speak about polarized neutron superconductor thermal.
Mm-hmm.
в любом случае такой усилитель
Dear colleagues, sorry for the delay. Let me start. That's the title of my talk. I would like to talk today about superconducting ferromagnetic superlattices and how we studied them with polarizing quantum reflectometry. So, as a for previous talk, I would like to jump a bit from the condensed matter physics to the beautiful world of nuclear physics, elementary particles, etc. So this is the you know the elementary table. And many years ago, I was a PhD student in Dubna, and there is a big nuclear center over there. And one of the laboratories is doing research just to prolong the periodic table. And at that time, I think they discovered element number 105, which they called after the name of the city, Dubnium. And at that time, when I saw this title, I was wondering, okay, so it's like vanadium is superconductor, niobium superconductor, tantalum superconductor. What about dubnium? Is it a superconducting or not? And of course, the discovery was done on something like a 4 or 5 atoms, and nobody can predict whether this element will be superconducting if you have just 5 atoms. So you need to have crystal structure, right, to be able to know this. And actually, our aim is maybe something similar. So if we already studied quite well SF interface, but if you want to use this atom and construct starting from the one-dimensional crystal structure, so will such a object will have different properties rather than one SF bilayer? And actually, theoreticians are on our side. There are I don't know, a lot or several works which were dealing with such structures. So, for example, one of pioneering of Proshin, Izumov, and Kostolinov, and they considered SF superlattice and found that depending on the thicknesses of the layers and also on the transparency and others parameters, one may have zero-zero phase. So that's the phases of superconductivity and ferromagnetism, or pi zero, zero pi, pi pi. And yeah, so the most interesting probably these zero pi phases, where the energetically favorable to have anti-parallel alignment of ferromagnetic layers. And two more recent works where I was lucky to be part of this. So in this work, we considered a structure which consisted of two thick superconductors and a periodic structure between them, which again consists of thin superconductors and ferromagnetic layers. And so the calculations, which were done by Sergei and Nikolai, both are in audience, shows that so if we have a ferromagnetic alignment of our magnetic layers, then of course the Cooper pair, so the superconducting correlation penetration inside such a structure is not, it's difficult, so they don't penetrate inside. But if you somehow align them anti-parallel, then the condensate penetrates much easier. And so this can be considered a giant spin wolf prototype. And so we use polarized neutrons for the study of such a structures. Just a small introduction in the method. So we just shine with polarized neutrons on the sample at the small angle and reflect them. So the momentum transfer then is normally to the surface. And by changing polarization of incoming neutrons and outgoing, we measure four reflectivities, up, down, down. These are so-called non-spin flip reflectivities. And they give us information about depth profile of collinear part of magnetization inside our layer structure. And also very important channel is so-called spin flip scattering, plus, minus, minus, plus, or up, down, down, up. So this science projection of neutron spin before and after scattering on the direction of external field. And this spin flip scattering is of purely magnetic origin, so that the scattering on the non-collinear part of magnetization. So here I use the sign proportional, but actually in first broad approximation, this is just the Fourier transformation of all these profiles to the Q space. And yeah, this is our reflectometer in which is situated in research reactor in Garching near Munich. So suppose that the reactor is inside the wall, so the neutron goes somewhere there. And here we have monochromator and it reflects only one wavelength. And here we have polarizer, which polarizes our beam. There's a flight tubes, spin flipper one before the sample, spin flipper two after the sample. Here we have the sample position with different sample environment, like a cryostat. And also the feature of our machine is that we can make a combined neutron X-ray experience. So the, perpendicular we have a stage for an X-ray machine. And then some neutrons goes here. Here we have analyzer of polarization and finally detect them with the positional sensitive detector. And this is how it looks like in a naked state without any special equipment from top. So this is the path for neutrons, and orthogonally we have X-ray detector and X-ray source. So that moves together and allows for the simultaneous measurement of X-ray and neutron reflectivities. And now, just a picture which I like very much. So that's for if you don't look on the axis and show this picture to the superconducting people, they say, okay, that's the critical currents versus thickness of ferromagnet in SFS junction. But if you show it to the neutron guy, he will say, well, that's the reflectivity. So you have here total reflection edge and then interference oscillation, so called physical oscillation. So I'm really surprised by that. So different physics and so much the same behavior. Okay, so I've switched to the first example. This is our investigation of gadolinium niobium systems. So gadolinium is quite weak ferromagnet. Curie temperature is around 300 Kelvin. So that allows us to make Xi-F, so correlation depth of superconductivity in ferromagnet is 4 nanometers. So the data from this article was shown today by Andrei Vasenko, but it turned out that the single mode is not the right approximation anyway. So I think we are still quite close to this number. So this Xi-F is rather big, and it allows us to make a structure with, we play with the thickness of gadolinium, so we choose it a bit less than Xi-F, or order of Xi-F, and a bit more than Xi-F. And so we prepare periodic structure consisting of 10 such a bilayers with niobium 25 nanometers and variable thickness of gadolinium. So this is how the X-ray reflectivity looks like. This this vertical line is a specular reflection. You can see a lot of spots here. That's the break reflections from this super lattice. And also in the specular direction, you can see this so-called break sheets, which tells us that the in-plane properties of our interfaces are also statistically correlates. That actually the whole picture gives us improvement that the structure is really 10 very high repeated bilayers. And so then this is how polarized neutron reflectivity from such a structure looks like. So that was the sample with thinnest gadolinium layer. We just measured in saturation at low temperature, but still above TC. So we can see that's the above mentioned total reflection edge. And then we have six break peaks from the periodic structure. And so the black line is the spin up reflectivities, the red line is the spin down reflectivities. This, you see that they are significantly different. That tells us that the magnetic moment of gadolinium is not zero. So, and what we consider is so-called spin asymmetry. This is the difference of two reflectivities divided on their sum. And as I said, that's, one can show that the skin asymmetry is proportional to the Fourier transformation of magnetization profile. So then, when we fit this data, then we can get such a magnetic depth profile above TC, so that's 10 similar or equal gadolinium layers with has magnetization of a bit less than 1.5 kilogauss. So that's what's happened above TC. And then what we've done later, we just stayed on the first break peak and measured the spin asymmetry as a function of temperature. What we observed that below TC, the amplitude of the spin asymmetry was suppressed. And actually, that tells us that there is a suppression of magnetic signals of ferromagnetic layers. And if we, that was done at zero field cooled, if we heat up and cool down again in the same field, we see that effect is not present. And if you plot this this maximum difference as a function of thickness of gadolinium layers, we see that it decays. But even for the thickest layer, it's still non-zero. And we proposed very simple explanation. So, as I said above, to see if we apply magnetic field that penetrates inside the structure, we have a response of magnetic layers on this magnetic field. But when we cool down the system, we recall that. Design of our structure is so that the superconducting correlations exist actually everywhere, including the thin gadolinium layers. And what does it mean? That the whole structure actually behaves like one thick superconductor with embedded ferromagnets. So in principle, we can consider the structure as artificial magnetic superconductor. And what is necessary is that since it's a thick superconductor, it is able to expel magnetic field from inside, and since it expels some portion of the external magnetic field, then response of the gadolinium layers is less. So, in principle, we can think of this magnetic proximity effect as a try of a superconductor to suppress ferromagnetic ordering, which is not good for the superconductivity. And now I come to our next work, which was so the previous was like a toy planes, and now coming back to this, what I showed in the introduction, this pseudo spin wolf structure, that is our work, which was done in collaboration with a group of Anatoly Sidorenko, Roman Marai was involved, and also theoretical support was done by a group of Mikhail Kuprianov. Again, Nikolai Pyotr Sergey Bakursky, I am the audience, so actually a good half of the authors are here. And the theoretical calculation shows that we really can have a strong effect of spin wolf structure, but then the next task is to prepare such a structure which will be able to switch between ferromagnetic and anti-ferromagnetic states. And for this we use the concept of pseudo spin wolf. What does it mean? That we have chosen two ferromagnetic layers with slightly different thickness, which allowed us to get different coercivity field. So we prepared a structure which consisted of cobalt 1.5, then spaced with niobium 8 nanometers, then cobalt 2.5, niobium 8 nanometers. So this quadro layers was repeated 6 times and was spaced between two thick superconducting niobium layers. And so that's the how reflectivity looks like from this structure. Again, we can see this these break peaks, which tells us that actually the repeatability of the structure is quite good. And that was done at saturation field, and if we measure it at a small field after saturation in negative field, then we see appearance of this so-called non-integer break peaks, which tells us that the magnetic period is 2 times higher than the structural break peak. So we really prove by neutrons that we are able to switch all these layers anti-parallel simultaneously. And this is the intensity of the half peak as a function of external field. So if we magnetize in negative direction, go here, then we have this anti-ferromagnetic phase in magnetic fields between 10 and 50 Ørsted. And moreover, if we stop remagnetization here and release the field, then anti-parallel alignment will be still present at zero field, so the device can work at zero magnetic field. And so this is the work which we done. It was published, and just the one slide of what was not published. So we measured further the same sample using full polarization analysis, also with spin flip scattering. So these green and blue lines. And yeah, we saw again that there is a strong spin flip scattering. That means the structure is non-collinear. And if you plot again this phase diagram, how spin flip scattering at this 1/2 peak behaves, so that's more or less repeated what was on the previous slide. But in addition, we measured the same curve below TC, and we see that on this shoulder there is a difference. So a superconducting state. It looks like that the system tried to be non-collinear as long as possible. This is that if we stay here and measure the temperature dependence of the signal, we see that it correlates with TC. So with this, I would like to come to the conclusion. And yeah, so that's written here. So these objects which we just between us called metamaterials, except metamaterials, potentially interesting objects as element of superconductive electronics, but at this point we need to understand the physics of these structures, and that requires progressive development of theory on experiment. And neutrons, one of the most important experiments, so this is like our one where we can go further. Instead of one-dimensional theoretic structure, we can switch to two-dimensional structures where I think the physics is much more interesting and difficult. And thank you for your attention.
Actually, here it will be more questions to Nikolai Leonov, but with all these questions we will raise tomorrow at 2 o'clock with a press room tomorrow.
Okay, yeah, so we can. There's also time for discussion. Okay, so let's then thank Peter again and go to the next talk. Let me just arrive to the question and you can give it up.
Should explain a bit what I mean with these terms, because they might be not so familiar. This is a collaboration. This doesn't work.
Maybe this one.
Oh,
you can insert this one.
Battery is up. So this is a collaboration. So his main work is done by his PhD student, Rafael Klees, in my group. His collaboration is Gianluca Rastelli, also in Constance, and Carlos Cuevas in Madrid. All right, so I want to go a bit through the points. I make a general introduction, motivation about topology in solid state physics. Then I introduce the notion of quantum. Geometry of quantum states, which some of you might already know, but still I read it, and then I will introduce what I mean with Josephson matter, and then discuss our new ingredients here, which how to construct this Josephson matter and how to address the topology by microwave spectroscopy. So, topology in solid state physics is a very hot topic nowadays. Many people are working on that, and the idea is that to study geometrical properties of quantum states in crystals, and maybe the most prominent example is actually already quite old, or a bit older, the quantum Hall effect, which is a quantized Hall conductance in two-dimensional electron systems in the magnetic field, and by Saunders, it was shown by Saunders and others that this is related to a topological invariant, which is called the Chern number, which is related to the Berry curvature. Topology talk, you always have to show these two figures of a kind of apple or orange here, and a donut, which are topologically not equivalent because there's a hole, but as we mentioned, I'm from Germany, so we have actually a more complicated type of a topology which has three holes, which is again not different. Basically, this number is topologically invariant, which means, and it's robust, so that it's kind of protected against small perturbations. And this is kind of in many fields now discussed: topological insulators, topological superconductors, or also topological quantum computing. In topological insulators, there are several types. 2D topological insulators are something like the quantum Hall effect, which I already explained. I also have this edge stage, which kind of a signature of this topology. For example, the 3D topological insulator is realized here in this Mood-Zelenik or Bismuth-Tellurite material, and the dispersion relation looks like this, and it has this characteristic node here, so this looks like a two-dimensional Dirac masses, Dirac fermions, and this can, for example, be seen here in this ARPIS measurement. I want to stress here that with the ARPIS, you just measure the energies, so the bands, but you do not gain information about the states which are there. But this you can also do. This is called spin and angle resolve photo emission spectroscopy, which was done here, the same material actually. In that case, if you have polarized light, then you see a difference if you have left or right polarized light, if you look at the right direction. So you get more information by looking at this polarized spectroscopy, and keep this in mind for later for a big two-sample wave measure. So this basically tells us something more than just the energy levels. Okay, this was part one, motivation topology. Now, what is quantum geometry? It's a slightly more general thing to say than topology. We all know that if you have a state which depends on some parameters, and the eigenstate of atomy which depends on some parameters, then we know since Berry and others that if you evolve the state low-close parameter curve, we kind of get a geometric phase which has observable consequences. Okay, and you can ask a more general question: if you have the state depending on these parameters, if you move it around in parameter space, so to say, the state changes, and you can ask how much does it change. And this is combined in a quantity, so you can calculate the distance, which is of course related to the overlap of the states at the position phi and the position shifted by d phi, and then one can express this by a quantity called chi, which is actually the quantum geometric tensor, which has this definition here. It's a Hermitian tensor, so it has a real symmetric part and an imaginary anti-symmetric part. The symmetric part is called the quantum metric. So this is like the usual metric, you know, in relativity. And the anti-symmetric part is actually the Berry curvature, which is related to the topological number we discussed before. Okay. And there's a relation between all these quantities. There's this called Berry connection, which is just this kind of overlap of the state which is moved, which is not the gauge invariant quantity. But if we integrate it over a closed surface, we get the Berry phase, which is gauge invariant. Or if we calculate the Berry curvature, it's also a gauge invariant. And then if we integrate this over a closed manifold without boundaries, one can show that this is an integer, and this is actually this Chern number. This is, for example, for the quantum Hall effect, it gives the quantized Hall conductance. Okay, maybe let's skip the next slide, which is more a kind of an example of a spin, 1/2 in a magnetic field, which is maybe more for the school part of the lecture, and directly go to the next topic here. Yeah, so this was kind of the introduction about the quantum geometry. Now, there is this Josephson matter, which I introduced. And so I don't know, most of you are probably familiar with superconductivity and Andreev states and so on. Nevertheless, I kind of briefly say some words about this. So Andreev states are between two states between two superconductors, for example, with a different phase. And then it turns out that the energy depends on phase, and this can be conveniently calculated with this determinant formula from Banacker, which gives so the zeros of this equation gives the bound state energies, and the phases enter here in this expression. And what is well known is that for this kind of junction with some scattering probability in between, if we have a conventional junction, then we have the Andreev bound state energy follow from this formula. And if you plot this formula here for, I don't know, this is t like 0.9 or 0.99 or something like this, you get this phase dependence for these two states, if you want, plus and minus. And you see that at zero, you have this kind of anti-crossing here, which is because this would say states are not not topological in any usual. If we add spin orbit interaction and all this, and there's a huge literature about this, you also find that the states are in, not susceptible to big scattering, and you find the Andreev energy of this form with cosine phi over 2, and now you see that these two states cross at a phase difference of pi, and they are, therefore something's happening, so this is kind of protected by Kammerger's symmetry and so on. This basically means that something drastically changes, and this is in that case a parity. So something changes in the topology when I have a zero crossing. That's of unwave levels. That's kind of the message here. Now, some years ago, Nazarov and his group came up with the following observation. So they looked at the junction of Andreev states, but not with two superconducting leads, but with n superconducting leads, and in that case you not only have one phase difference, but you have n minus one phase differences, and of course the energy of the state will then depend on all these phase differences, and these phases phases you can see like an analogy to the K vector in a brilliant zone in a solid, and that's why we call this Josephson matter, because you can make like a dispersion relation in three dimensions or in whatever dimension here now. Of course, these are artificial synthetic dimensions, but things are similar. You can especially search for topological properties here. Okay, then you determine these bound states with some scattering matrix which connects all this, and then you find, for example, that these states live in a synthetic three-dimensional brilliant zone for four superconductors and depend on the three phase differences. I will show you this kind of dispersions later, which is an analogy to conventional topological superconductors. Now, it turns out that this might have zero crossings, so this is not forbidden in three dimensions here. And if we have a zero crossing, always that then something changes in the topology. Around the zero crossing, I can always, so to say, linearize the Hamiltonian, and this Hamiltonian is in relativity called the Weyl Hamiltonian. It's for three phases and three Pauli matrices here, if you want. And then and that's why these special points, the zero crossings, will be called Weyl points. Okay, then they searched randomly for scattering matrices, and they found some which have a zero crossing, which was kind of surprising, because if you just have one phase, you always have this level repulsion and so on. So in general, you will not find this only accidentally, but here you also you find it in the 3D, and it's actually the stuff. And then you can start with investigating the topology. Similar like in the quantum Hall effect, you can define the churn number by summing a Berry curvature over all over the whole Brillouin zone. Now, over a surface in the Brillouin zone, two-dimensional, which now depends still on the third phase. And then the 0 points they found are shown here. So this is phi 1, phi 2 in this direction, and phi 3 in this direction. And then you have the 0 points here, this red and blue points. And if you now integrate over this phi 1, phi 2 surface, and you move the surface up here, you see that each time one of these points crosses the surface, the churn number changes by an integer. So that's kind of nice. So we have a topologically non-trivial system. And then they actually extended it to the multi-channel case, so you can. This was such a single channel, and you see you can also get higher churn numbers. So, for example, here you have this crazy states. Okay, then the question is how to measure this. You can show that you can measure this, that's what they claim, via the quantized transconductor. So, you measure the current in terminal 1 as a function of a small voltage in terminal 2 and average this over the time, which average current. And then it turns out that this is quantized in units of 4e squared over h times this churn number. Okay, now one of the problems they was that they basically used random scattering matrices, and this is difficult for experimentalists to kind of, you want to have a certain construction scheme, plan what to do to create this. So that's why we asked ourselves, how can we, so to say, let's construct some system like this and then see if it has topological properties. So, what we looked at two different geometries. One was with four superconducting terminals, one with three. And then we, so to say, if we take the simplest model, take a single level quantum dot, we couple it with some parameter W to this superconductors, and we add some direct coupling between the superconductors. So the particles, they can make some kind of interfering paths here through that. so that's the system we looked at. I'm telling you this because we defined non-trivial topology here. We also looked at the system with three terminals, which is similar to one which was studied by Jose and Weyer. But in that case, you need a magnetic flux here, which is actually a bit more complicated. Okay. So the question is then, can we describe this as an effective spin 1/2 system with so to say, a kind of synthetic magnetic field which depends on these phase differences, which is basically, if you want, so the direction of certain, the direction of certain, the absolute value of the magnetic field are. And the question is, of course, the 0 point is this vector d is 0. Okay, so just quickly, the theory is kind of pretty standard. Dot Hamiltonian, superconductor Hamiltonian, all the couplings. Just for completeness here, dot with some level energy epsilon 0, BCS Hamiltonian for the leads, depending on the phases. Dot lead coupling with the parameter w, and lead lead coupling with the parameter t. And then for simplicity, let's assume that we put delta to infinity, when the lex is and so on, but it simplifies a bit, actually strongly if you want, and we take this weak coupling here, then we can solve everything analytically and find the Green's function on the dot has this form, in the, so to say, low energy Hamiltonian for states below the superconducting. Okay, and this is then a pseudo spin in number space here. Okay, and here's the expression for D, which follows in our calculation. Now, of course, the phases, one of the phases is put to zero essentially here. So this is this D vector here. These are parameters. There's gamma, which is this coupling between the dot and the superconductor, and T is the coupling. It's parameterizing direct coupling, this dimensionless number. Okay, now we check, do we find, the energies are simple, they're just the absolute value of D. Okay, now the question is, can we, when do we find points which have D equal to zero? And this is easily calculated, in that limit. So we find a certain region where we have the zeros. Okay, this means we can study the topology as a function of this parameter. The other are the phases in this region, and these are the diagram of the Y nodes which we find, phi 1, phi 2, phi 3. Here we have these different Y nodes for this set of parameters, which is of course in this regime. This is, for example, typically dispersions, how they look like. These are like now two-dimensional bands, function of phi 1 and phi 2, and sometimes for this red point here you have one y node, for this pi, this is this blue surface here, you have two y nodes here and here. Okay, now we can also calculate, just go through this already explained, now you can calculate the Chern number, because it is two-level approximation, it is pretty straightforward, because one only needs this d vector. Everything can be expressed by this normalized d vector, so we can calculate this metric, we can calculate the Verrick curvature, and from this we calculate the Chern number, and if we go along this control phase, phi 3, we see that we kind of have a topological trivial region, then we go through the first state, and we have a jump to minus 1, for example, then we cross two y points at the same time, we have a jump by 2, plus 2 in this case, and then it goes down again. And of course, this has to be periodic, so we have to end up here again. Okay, so we have a nice system where we can find this topology, in which it's not so easy to construct it experimentally, but at least there's a Hamiltonian which we can, in principle, translate it. So then the second question is, there's a certain advantage of studying these systems not with transport, but studying them with microwaves. Mainly, you can simply decouple them from the external world, so you don't need current lines and so on. And this, so to say, increases the coherence. And that's why many people, many things are not done with microwaves. Okay, So just to introduce microwave spectroscopy, this was one of the first papers here of Andreev levels. They can create this kind of junction where they can introduce some Andreev levels. And then they observed them in the microwave picture. It's, you see there are more lines, so it's more complicated, it's not so straightforward. But you see phase dependence here nicely shown, and you see this is kind of the topologically trivial case. You just have this kind of phase dependence, is exactly what follows from this formula from Wienerker, which I showed you in the beginning. Okay, and so you find these absorption lines for the bounded energies, but these are just the energies. You want to know something about the states. And there's a general idea how to access the geometry. It's the following: if you have a Hamiltonian and you have a ground and an excited state, let's assume we have only those two, then the quantum geometric tensor is actually related to this matrix elements. And for example, the diagonal elements are that. So now, if you drive just one parameter, let's say one of these phases, that's just microwave absorption, if you want, and put this in Fermi's golden rule. This is just Fermi's golden rule. We have some, okay, maybe some broadening effects also. Anyhow, we have this kind of matrix element, and by a simple manipulation of this form, we can write this matrix element in this form, and this is already what you see what appears here in this quantum geometric tensor. So basically, if you just look at the intensity line, so you integrate this frequency if you want, you see that the intensity is proportional to the quantum geometric, to the matrix, to the diagonal elements of the matrix. Okay, this is we drive one parameter. Now comes the key point. if we want to do this, to access the other quantities, is obviously not enough. But what is enough is to drive two parameters with the same frequency, but with a controlled phase difference, gamma. So this is basically, you can do exactly the same thing, Fermi's golden rule. And then you find that depending on this gamma, you find these intensities. And then you actually can show straightforward, if you compare phase difference gamma equals zero and gave phase difference gamma equal pi, you exactly have the off diagonal elements of the quantum matrix. And if you compare pi over 2 and minus pi over 2, you exactly observe the variation of the. So that's very nice, right? So basically this means you can measure these lines, the absorption lines, for different polarizations, if you want. And this is like generalized polarization. This is like circular polarized light in real space, right? You have electric field in x and y direction, and if you have phase difference of pi over 2, that's circularly polarized light. So it's kind of synthetically polarized, circularly polarized microwaves. Okay, so this is basically the kind of summary. So you can access not only the very curvature, but all ingredients of the quantum geometric tensor. If you drive one phase, you know, it's linear polarized in say x and y direction, you get the diagonal elements of the geometric tensor. If you have 0 and pi, then you have this kind of polarizations, then you measure the off-diagonal elements, and if you compare circularly polarized lights, you see the very curvature, and that's how you come to determine all the full quantum geometric tensor. And I emphasize that in this two-level state, this gives you all the information about the states of the system, actually. Yeah? Not only the energies, but really information about the states. Okay, yeah, so this is just okay, so that's basically all I wanted to say here, mainly because now we have constructed the system where you can observe this topology with the Hamiltonian approach, and we have found a way to address this topology with microwaves. I have some plots here of the very curvature, if you want. So this is kind of the energy surface, and then you see this is always strong, where you have a strong curvature here in energy. This is, for example, a trivial phase where you have positive and negative parts which cancel out. And in another, for another certain phase, you see many blue parts, and then you see this kind of gives a non-trivial variable curvature. So this is the difference between left and right circular polarized, like normalized. Okay, so that's essentially the summary. Yeah, so the summary is that we have proposed this kind of system which shows a non-trivial shows these while points and has a non-trivial topology depending on the parameters, and we have shown how to address this by, so to say, generalized microwave polarized microwave spectroscopy, which allows the whole quantum geometry tensor. All right, and with this I'm done. And thank you for your attention.
So, time for discussion.
So, you basically define this transconductor journal, but it's all in the superconducting state, so this means there is an AC just that doesn't appear with the zero.
Yes.
Okay. Because on side square term that comes only if you have a square number.
And this was not our, this was kind of the version of the Zabos. Yeah, but you're right, yeah. Of course, it's significant to study the linear conductance in the superconducting state because you also have a supercurrent P. Yeah, so it's kind of.
So you assume short ballistic junctions, yeah, in this case, or yes. It is not necessary. What happens if you have, for example, long junction?
Right. So in some sense, then you have more Andreev states, and then the situation is more complicated. So in our case, we model this, and we did model this in the meantime with say different dots, for example. So if you take more dots. You also have more states, and then you have more, in some sense, then you have, in this case with the dots and without spin, and the number of states is given by the number of dots. And then if you want, you can calculate this Barrett curvature for each state. Each state has an energy, and you can calculate this Barrett curvature and so on. But the spectroscopy is, of course, more difficult, right, because you we have many more transitions possible, and so on, and so this is something we haven't studied in detail.
Okay. Yes, I understand. So, maybe last question?
And I just want to say this. The summer school, Professor Benzig will give a lecture, that's why we can more profound discuss on Saturday. On Saturday, morning, Professor Smetsik will have a lecture. That's why please keep in mind your question. Thank you.
Thank you. Last talk today from Dr. Igor Belochevsky from MIT. He's here in Moscow. And the interplay of spin waves is a magnetic current and Fermat is superconductor.
Structures by coupling magnetization dynamics to Meissner responses for superconducting. First, a brief introduction into magnetization dynamics, magnonics. Everything revolves around the Landau-Lichtz-Gilbert equation. The first term of this equation describes precessional motion of a macro spin of magnetic moment around magnetic field. And the second term is basically a damping of this motion. And it follows from this equation that if you have a magnetic body, in applied magnetic field, and if you apply AC field in perpendicular direction, you excite a precession of magnetic moment. And in certain field and frequency, the amplitude will be maximum. So that's what the ferromagnetic resonance is. And the dependence of this resonance on magnetic field is given by Kittel formula, which also contains information about the size and shape of a ferromagnet via the demagnetizing factors. And if a resonance is excited, the line width of this resonance usually is proportional to this Hilbert parameter alpha. Nowadays, one of the most common ways to study magnetization dynamics is using the so-called DNA-FMR approach, where DNA stands for vector network analyzer and FMR, ferromagnetic resonance. So usually you have a coplanar waveguide or any waveguide. You place a ferromagnetic field on top of it, the flip chip geometry. You apply a magnetic field along this direction and transmit microwave signals. And these microwave signals, they induce AC magnetic field in this direction, so the FMR condition is fulfilled, magnetization is excited, and when FMR condition is met, you have the minimum of transmission of microwave signal, because the signal is absorbed by this precession motion. And usually you just change magnetic field and scan frequency band, and you have a series of these absorptions, and you restore the entire equal curve. In general, this Kittel mode, the ferromagnetic resonance, can be viewed as a magnon with a zero wave number, with a zero wave vector. And if a spin wave motion is decided, it's a dispersion actually depends a lot on the geometry. For example, in case of when magnetic field is out of plane, the so-called forward volume mode can be excited. This is it's a dispersion law. If you have in-plane wave vector and also in-plane magnetic field that are co-aligned, you can excite the backward volume mode. And usually it is of a specific interest because it has negative group velocity. It is here. And probably one of the most popular is the magnetostatic surface spin wave mode. It can be excited when the magnetic field is in plane and the wave vector is also in plane but in perpendicular direction. It is called the surface wave because unlike for two previous cases, for this case the energy of the wave is localized on a particular surface. And for all these three modes, when the wavelength becomes comparable with the exchange length, the exchange interaction becomes dominated and all these dispersions start to gain this parabolic curvature. And in magnonics and magnetization dynamics, one of the things that you can do is by any means to create a modulation, periodic modulation of any property that is related to this dispersion. For example, saturation magnetization, anisotropy field, stress, exchange, whatever. And you can expect that if you create such periodic modulation at a certain wave number that corresponds to the period of this perturbation, the band gap will be opened. And usually magnetic crystals they are considered as a magnetic counterpart of famous photonic crystals. They are considered to be very important in magnonics for some logic devices, for grating couplers, and some other things. Well, this is a general introduction. It was a general introduction to magnonics. There are three basic ways for interaction of magnetization dynamics with the superconductor. The first one that I won't talk too much is via electromagnetic or electronic proximity effect. There are some reports that in case if the hybrid structure is formed, the proximity effect exerts additional torque on macrospins and it sort of shifts the dispersion. The other way is to interact via the vortex matter. In case if you have a hybrid, moving vortices that are moved by applied current can actually excite magnons, and vice versa. If you have a perfect hexagonal vortex lattice, you can expect that spin waves that propagate in ferromagnetic media will interact with this periodic structure, and some band gaps will be opened. And the last one that we will talk about is via Gould-Meissner state, because superconductor can be also always viewed as ideal diamagnet, and it tries to expel all magnetic fields, and by doing that, it actually enhances fields just next to its edge. And we are coming to the first experiment that we'll talk about. We studied ferromagnetic resonance in a permolyethylene film that is placed directly on top of a superconducting film. We did this type of a chip, so it's a waveguide that is folded into a meander, and we placed a series of permolyoid rectangles of thickness 100 nanometer, I think, and the length 1 millimeter. And for this structure, we studied FMR absorption at temperatures above and below superconducting critical temperature. So this is the typical VNA FMR spectrum. It was measured at temperature above TC of niobium, and it contains only a single FMR line. This is the FMR absorption. But when we go to lower temperatures, on top of this signal, we also have a series of additional resonances. And these are cross-sections of this transmission spectrum, like so here are these additional modes. And well, we can immediately state that something happens, and superconductivity does induce additional spin wave resonances. We need to figure out which ones, because there are several modes. And we can state that due to geometry, these are the surface modes. Why? Because for forward volume mode, you need the outer plane magnetic field, which is not the case for us. For backward volume mode, you have negative group velocity. So if a wave resonance will be excited, you would expect to have a resonance frequency below the FMR frequency, which is not the case here. So the surface mode is actually the only option left. And since this is the surface mode, in our case, in our geometry, the wavelength should be quantized with the width of this film. And we can use the dispersion law to actually plot these resonance curves. They are here with this dashed lines, and we see that indeed they are in the same range as our experiment, but also they just mismatch completely experimental data. So at this point we can state that not only superconductivity does excite the spin wave resonance, but it does something with the phase velocity. And how does it do it? Well, we can use the good old image method. When the ferromagnet is placed on top of a superconductor screens the strain magnetic fields that are induced by magnetic moments in the ferromagnet. And it is equivalent for creation of images of these magnetic moments in the superconductor. And we basically took this model and included it into the micromagnetic simulations and simulated the dependence of absorption on frequency. The red curve here is in absence of this image method, and the black one is in presence of this image method. And we have the same for the weak resonances as we had in the experiment. So we do confirm that this is due to screen effect. On this plot, you see the frequency difference between the FMR frequency and the spin wave resonance frequency for the case of absence of image, and for calculations and for experiment in presence of images. And you see this deviation. First of all, you see a very good match between experiment and simulations. And second, you see this deviation. In this image, this position corresponds basically to the phase velocity. So we can state that in presence of superconductivity, the phase velocity of spin waves is enhanced by approximately one factor of 1.5. To understand it closer, we run simulations in order to obtain the actual dispersion law. On this plot, with dashed lines, you have theoretical dispersion curves. Black ones are simulated one in absence of a superconductor, and red ones are in presence. So we see that, first of all, phase velocity is enhanced. And actually, for the positive wave numbers, the passband is doubled. That's why we had this factor of 1.5 in experiment, because The standing wave is a superposition of the forward and reflected one. The forward one is propagated with a double phase velocity, and the negative one is just with regular velocity. And well, why does this non-reciprocity happen? This is actually a known thing for surface spin waves. The thing is that usually it propagates on a particular surface depending on the orientation of the wave vector relation orientation to the wave vector to the applied field. And for positive k, it propagates just at the surface at the interface between ferromagnet and superconductor, and that's why the spin wave does interact with Mason currents. But in other case, in for opposite direction, it just propagates on the opposite surface and there is no interaction. Well, ourselves, we are from a superconducting community, and at the beginning we thought that we actually found something interesting, but it appears that for magnetic community, such effect was actually known quite some time ago for the case of ferromagnetic and ideal conductor bilayers. And moreover, using this concept, quite some time ago, these kind of experiments were done in combination of high-temperature superconductor and dielectric magnets, and where people actually observed enhancement of the phase velocity. Well, the second part of my talk will be about the possibility to fabricate a magnetic crystal based on these heterostructures. In order to check this possibility, we basically performed the same fMRI experiment, but this time we placed a ferromagnetic film and also a superconducting grid on top of it and measured the fMRI. Before placing this grid or at temperatures above TC, we have the same fMRI response, nothing special. But at temperatures below TC, this fMRI is splitted. So we can state here that how did it actually work? Since a superconductor is an ideal diamagnet, these superconductors expel magnetic field and they enhance it in the regions just below these stripes and reduces it in the region in between these stripes. And we have calculated the distribution of this DC magnetic field. And also we have to put into account the images of these superconducting stripes, because all this structure is placed again on top of the superconducting waveguide. And by calculating this additional field, we can now put this into the Kittel formula and check where the fMRI curve should go. And here they are with these dashed lines. So we see they do match experimental data at this lower region and then just start to mismatch it at high fields. So what happens here? Here probably vortices start to penetrate. So this field is the first critical field, about 10 millitesla. And at fields higher than this field, vortices penetrate, but Meissner currents still persist, and that's why you still have this effect, so that this fMRI curve is still splitted. Well, we know that we did create a periodic modulation of a DC field, but will it actually help us to form the magnetic crystal? And the answer is yes. So we placed these estimations of periodic magnetic field into micromagnetic simulations and derived the dispersion of such structure, and this is the band structure of such structure. We see that the band gaps are opened at exactly at Brillouin wave numbers, and these band gaps are actually quite substantial. They are a few hundreds of megahertz. And I repeat once again that in this case it happens due to DC screening of external magnetic field. When we turn ourselves to the surface spin wave mode, when magnetic field should be applied along these stripes, this DC screening will not work just due to the demagnetizing factors. However, the band structure should still be formed, because these stripes will screen the stray fields of spin waves. And we calculated the band structure for the same crystal but in different orientation of magnetic field. And we see that, first of all, this spectrum is shows substantial non-reciprocity, well, because this is the surface mode. Also, we see that some gaps are actually opened for positive wave numbers due to the same reason. But Also, what is interesting, these band gaps are indirect because they are open away from the brilliant wave numbers, which is actually a consequence of this non-reciprocity. Well, and it rapidly brings me into my conclusions that in general, yes, you can expect tunability of the dispersion of spin waves by coupling it to a superconductor. You can expect a variety of different band structure and dispersion laws. And also, what is important, micromagnetic simulations are very helpful and efficient. And well, basically, by this work, they are confirmed with experiments. Thank you for your attention.
Time for questions.
This artificial magnets, monoclinic crystals.
Well, right now we do a particular work to study experimentally the dispersion of magnetic crystals. So far, we have measured FMR of such structures, so it's not the same. Because to study experimentally the dispersion, you need to excite and receive spin waves. And we excite and measure the Kittle mode, so uniform precession. But by having this experimental result, we see that there are regions with a different FMR frequency. With different FMR frequency means that they are different DC fields, regions with different DC fields. Then we use basically like a part of micromagnetic simulation that is responsible for population of this distribution. And we used it here to plot these curves. And we see that this part, well, it sufficiently accurately describes this distribution. So we sort of verified it. Then we used again basically this law, plugged it into micromagnetic simulation, and then, well, then we received the band structure. This is the simulation that we so far. Well, and also I want actually to point out that this screening law is very different from the image method, because this one considers only screening from like a particular small volume. It's a kind of a different story.
So,
experimental data we showed in the very beginning is just a paramagnetic bar line on top of the coconut waveguide.
Yep.
I didn't quite notice yet. It doesn't seem like you have a signature between the positive and negative sides.
That's true.
You just explained that it should be.
This is the dependence of FMR frequency on magnetic field. The fact is that except of this tiny part here, this thing is reversible. It means that the ferromagnet itself is reversible. There is no hysteresis. On this part, I'll move backward this way. Here, we see the resonance frequency on the wave number. And like for positive wave numbers, it is enhanced. For negative wave numbers, it is not. But we are talking about spin wave resonance, which means that we have a standing spin wave. We have a superposition of forward wave and a backward wave. The forward wave is going with this phase velocity, the backward one is reflected with this phase velocity. So that's why they are symmetrical. And that's why that the enhancement is only a factor of 1.5.
Transmission.
Well, reflection basically would show approximately the same. It's just in reflection you would expect some issues with a regular microwave reflection that is not related to FMR. It's a bit more tricky, to my opinion.
So, no more questions. So let's close this session today.
Thank you.